The idea of compressing the forwarding table has been discussed for a while in the networking industry. Actually, it is used very successfully in live networks with Juniper routers, and probably without you even noticed it. That's what we are going to detail in this video. We'll try to answer the following questions today. What are the key concepts behind FIB compression technology? What kind of products can enable it? What could be the limitations? How efficient it is in the best case for a public internet table? And finally, we will verify the performance of the algorithm in real production networks. The concept of FIB, or forwarding information base, should be very familiar to most of the network engineers. In a nutshell, it's a table containing the routes. That means prefixes, subnet mask, and next stop details required by the packet forwarding engine during the lookup phase. The PFE compares the destination address to the table entries and decides where the packet should be sent to. In early 2023, if a router contains a full internet table, and that's the case for multiple roles like peering, we have to install in hardware more than 942,000 IPv4 and 173,000 IPv6 routes. It's a large quantity of prefixes. A rough approximation leads to the idea that an IPv6 route occupies twice the space of an IPv4 one, simply because the vast majority of the public table is made of /24s for IPv4 and /48s for IPv6. With this logic, internet uses 1.3 million FIB entries, and we are not even counting the more specific routes advertised via private peering or the ones coming from IGP. Depending on the network, it could represent dozens of thousands of extra entries. The internet size growth doesn't seem to slow down, and we will need to create routers that will support this scale in 10 years or more. That's why it's not unreasonable today to propose hardware supporting a minimum of 4 million FIB entries. To handle this large quantity of information, multiple approaches have been investigated. The FIB compression is one of them, and not necessarily orthogonal to the others. Depending on the organization, routes can be aggregated, and we can reduce the size they occupy in the ASIC memory if they respect certain conditions. It's interesting to note that aggregation is slightly different in the FIB than from a BGP perspective. For example, in this CIDR report aggregation summary pages, the aggregated routes are representing the blocks allocated to the different companies present on the internet. Basically, the routes coming from a specific autonomous system. With FIB compression, we don't really care about BGP information like ASPath. We will only consider prefix, subnet mask, and next stop address. By the way, I invite you to read this pretty interesting article published by Sharada relative to the longest prefix matching in networking chipsets. It's really good. You will find the link in the description. The key concepts behind FIB compression are very basic. The first rule is the shadowing principle. If I receive a route with a forwarding behavior similar to an existing superset, it doesn't bring any useful information, I don't program it. For example, if I receive two routes, 192.0.2.4/30 and 192.0.2.6/31, both pointing to NH1, I don't need to program the /31. It will occupy space for nothing. The second principle is the compression itself. If many routes can be aggregated into a superset, just program this one and not the contributing prefixes. Imagine we received four host routes, represented here in light blue. So we have four IPv4/32, all pointing to the same next stop NH1. They have a similar forwarding behavior. I represent them in binary. The first 30 bits of these four prefixes are identical, and that's my subnet mask. And the last two are covering all possible combinations. That gives us 192.0.2.12/30 pointing to NH1. We will only install this entry in the FIB, and it will provide the exact same service, then having four host routes, and of course, it will occupy just a quarter of the memory space. In this diagram, the blue color represents the routes received from the RIB. Could they be direct, static, or advertised via a dynamic protocol? And in green, we have the computed aggregated routes. Dotted line means it's not installed, and normal lines represent what is programmed in hardware. So you can see I aggregated and only programmed 192.0.2.12/30. It's super basic, I told you. Of course, these two principles are used at high scale. And you understand easily that depending on the organization, having a lot of prefixes pointing to the same next stop address could reduce the size of the table significantly, even if they are actually advertised by different autonomous systems. Let's take a slightly larger example. Here, I received 12 prefixes, /32s and /31s, all pointing to next stop 1, NH1. With this graphical representation, it's an iterative process. At each level, the system creates aggregates when it's possible. At higher level, they can be themselves associated with received prefixes or other aggregates, and on, up to this /28 summary. In this other example, I do receive a bunch of /32s, /31s, and 1/30, but with two different next stop addresses. Quickly, we reach a point where routes pointing to NH1 cannot be gathered with routes pointing to NH2, and that's how far the compression can go. I've been asked this question several times. If certain entries are missing to build an aggregate, can we create some negative routes to fill the gaps? The answer is no. If there is no contributor to create the aggregate, we don't invent a route pointing to null zero. The algorithm keeps it simple. In this example, the 192.0.2.12/32 is not present, and therefore the structure will be compressed into four entries and not just one. Another interesting subtlety to understand, having a more specific route pointing to a different next stop doesn't prevent the algorithm from creating the aggregate. In this example, I have five routes. 192.0.2.5/32 points to NH2, while all other /31s point to NH1. We can still create the aggregate to 192.0.2.0/29 and end up with these two prefixes installed in hardware. The FIP compression algorithm is implemented in multiple Juniper products. Since 21.2R1, it's activated by default in PTX routers powered by Express4 packet forwarding engines. That's the PTX 10001 36MR and the LC1201 and 1202 in the PTX 10K chassis. Also, in 2023, it will be implemented in the SCX 7K family. It works for IPv4 and IPv6 unicast routes, regardless of the advertising protocol, even static or direct, and it works equally well in VRFs. It has no impact on URPF, unicast river path forwarding. We didn't implement compression for multicast routes. Even if technically speaking it will be doable, the typical multicast table size doesn't really justify the effort. Enabling some features could prevent the compression. That's the case for SCU-DCU, source destination class usage. Nothing to do in terms of configuration. The routes involved are simply flagged internally as not being part of the compression. In terms of hardware implementation, the compression is done inside the process, just before pushing the routes into the PFE. In the PTX case, it will be in EVO Aftman BT, and in the SCX, it will be in EVO PFE MANDI. The compression is not affecting the RIB, it's not even involving FIBD. So that's why it has no impact on operations between protocols like redistribution. Before checking how it works in production, there is one lab test that's gonna give us an interesting information. You understand that compression ratio will depend on the route organization, but also on the next stop distribution. The base case scenario is when we inject routes from a unique next stop address. This test will tell us how far we can compress the public table. I'm advertising both V4 and V6 full table that represent 930K V4 and 161K V6 entries from a unique route injector. And we check the compression ratio. That's 82% for IPv4. Interesting because we will see more and more IPv4 disaggregation in the future, and therefore higher and higher compression opportunities. Also, it's surprising to see that the current IPv6 table, despite this huge addressable space, can still be compressed at 72%. But again, it represents an absolute best case scenario. Now, let's take a look at the performance in production environment. We asked a couple of our customers to send us the output of specific CLI to identify the number of routes, the compression ratio, and the number of next stop addresses they see in their live routers. And the results are very good, with a FIP space reduction from 55 to 60%. So it's fair to say that FIP compression doubles the FIP space. For more details, I invite you to read the TechPost article linked below. It contains much more details and also some additional tests on route churn performed in our labs to verify it has no impact on traffic. Okay, let's wrap it up. FIP compression is enabled by default in the latest PTX generation and will come soon on the SCX 7K routers. It's a very efficient mechanism that doubles the FIP space in complete transparency for the operator. See you in the next one.